Well, it's been a journey of 11 years and 11 winners. So I really think that the Srinivas Rayaprol Literary Trust establishing the Poetry Prize has finally come of age. And I'm more thrilled because Debarshi is also here today. So we have our prize winner of 2016. That was 15, that was Aishwarya Iyer. And 2017, that's the ninth prize, that's Debarshi Mitra. And of course, Prashant, who is the current winner. So this is indeed a very special moment. And I am going to say very little about the prize because today we also, my sister and I need not introduce Srinivas Rayaprol to this crowd because it has been done already by people who have, you know, read him, and it's been quite a beautiful moment. But we started the poetry prize on his name to remember Indian English poetry. And I must say that we have had the support of almost every major Indian English poet. We have friends like Jerry who have put us in touch with the seniors from Mumbai, and that has been absolutely wonderful. And the prize began in collaboration with the Department of English at the University of Hyderabad, and we have had the strong partnership. We have also donated Srinivas Rayaprol collection of books to the Department of English, and I'm so grateful that Graziano is going to see them himself at this particular point of time. As far as the jury is concerned, we've had the support of Sudeep Sen, Jeet Tail, Srilata, Arundhati Subramaniam, Manohar Shetty, Ranjit Hoskote, Vivek Narayanan, Keki Daruwala, Arvind Krishna Mehrotra, E.V. Ramakrishnan, Jeev Patel. And so it has been, I can say very happily, that there is absolutely no one who has refused to be on the jury so far, and it has been a wonderful experience. And I'm looking to the younger poets who are now coming of age, who will join the jury in the coming years as well. As far as the winners are concerned, many poets now know their names very well. Our first winner, Aditi Machado, doing very well. Hemant Mohapatra, Aditi Rao, Tushar Jain, Mihir Vats, Ranjani Murali, Aishwarya Iyer, Gaurik Brahmachari, Debarshi Mitra, Purna Swami, and now Prashant Parvataneni. So we are very, very happy that, you know, we are all here to present this. Before I introduce Prashant formally, I'd like to welcome him onto the dais, please. Please come, Prashant. You already have a fan following from yesterday, I note. Have a seat. So, Prashant Parvataneni is an independent writer, young independent writer and artist, based again in Bangalore, like some of our other winners, especially Aishwarya and Purna. So he won the Srinivas Rayaprol Poetry Prize this year. He was chosen for the prestigious prize from a field of 170 contestants. It's been up and down, but it's been above 100, I can say that very easily, from around the country by a jury consisting of eminent poet, playwright and artist Jeev Patel. And Jeev Patel, I had approached 2 years ago and he was unwell, but we were persuasive enough and he was nice enough. So I think that has been absolutely wonderful. It's just apart from Adil, I think every one of the senior poets has already been on the jury. Two faculty members from the Department of English at the University of Hyderabad. This time it was Professor Murali Manohar and Girish Pawar. So apart from Prashant, we had two people who were shortlisted by Jeev Patel and the jury, and they are Ashika Suresh and Shabnam Parveen. I'd like to announce their names as well for being on the shortlist. Now, Prashant is on a collective called Brown Study, which works towards developing forms of thinking and experimenting with artistic texts and experiences. As a researcher and translator, he also works with the Kabir Project at the Srishti Foundation of Art on an online archive of poems from Sufi and Bhakti traditions. His articles on art and cinema have appeared in magazines like Seminar, the Bangalore Review, and Deep Focus Cinema. So that's why he hosted the cinema talk with Aishwarya yesterday. Through his various creative and critical pursuits, Prashant is interested in understanding the place of art, life, and politics. And recognized as a significant award for this writing now, I think people have been talking about the Poetry Prize, and it was instituted by the trust, which is really our family, to recognize excellence in poetry written in English by poets in the age group of 20 to 40 years. And it is, as I said, jointly administered by the Department of English, University of Hyderabad. I am really grateful and thrilled that Graziano Kratli has arranged his trip in such a way that he could come to Hyderabad to present this prize. We do it either on 25th October, my father's birth anniversary, or in January. And Amita Desai, of course, suggested that we do it as part of the festival. So thanks again, Graziano, and may I request you to present the award. Yes, please put it around his neck. You could give it to him.
I want to, before giving Prashant the prize, I want to read what a quotation from Jeev Patel that is actually inscribed on the prize, and it's important to keep in mind. For the assured handling of feelings and situations that exist between the tentative and the precise. And I think it's a wonderful quotation.
May I also invite Professor Anna Kurian onto the dais? Thank you. May I present the translations as well. Anna, just a moment. I would like to give you all. I'll do it. Thank you very much for the collaboration. Thank you. Thank you. The stage is all yours now, Prashant.
Thank you so much. It's so overwhelming in a way because not just because so many people are here for this, including a lot of friends and family who I've literally grown up with. It's such a sudden coming together of so many kinds of people. And more than that, I think what this prize represents and what we just saw happen just before the prize giving was so moving, because the question that Srinivas Rayaprol asks in one of his letters, which was read here, and is so poignant and perhaps so crucial, the question of why should I write a poem now? It's a question that almost holds you by your collar and demands an answer. It is a question which, as Rayaprol said about a letter, is as insistent as poetry itself. It's an insistent question, and it's a pertinent question, and it's a question that I hope, as poets, we always think about. Why should I write a poem now? This is a question that I keep asking myself, and the answer that I have, the only answer that I have perhaps, is because poetry is utterly beautiful. It is a thing of beauty. And as Keats said, what is beautiful is really true. And I think because it is so beautiful, it is hard to ignore. And we really need really beautiful things to make us stop being indifferent to what is happening around us and what is happening inside us. just this morning I was sitting amongst a group of people who were almost in a stark comedic way joking about NRC and CAA and all that is happening, while I was just sitting and I was thinking, what is the role of poetry now? What is the role of poetry now? Is there anything that I can do as a poet to bring a thing of beauty and which can perhaps cut through this this sort of insensitivity, which can cut through or perhaps say something which is beautiful and true? The poignancy of the fact that I'm receiving this award in the hands of Graziano is not lost on me. Today, as we are celebrating the work of a poet, we are also celebrating the work of a librarian, and who has worked so tirelessly in excavating and preserving the culture of poetry, and as Jerry said, a culture of generosity, sheer generosity between poets. And if poetry can do something in this really ungenerous times, it is perhaps to create a sense of generosity. And the poignant, I call this particular moment poignant because I have to say this. It's not a way to sort of get attention about something, but I have to say this because of who I'm also addressing. Because of what happened on December 15th in Jamia Millia Islamia, where tear gas bombs were thrown into the library compound. And at that point, if as a poet who has spent most of his time in the library, learned all that he has perhaps in the library, and what do we do in the face of it? What kind of poem do we write in the face of that? I have written a poem. I don't think it is in any way a making sense of it, but in fact, it is almost a poem that is born out of an irritation, a poem which is also refusing to stick to the narrative which is being spun. And it is a poem where this library, unlike, I mean, what the fascist state would want libraries to be, is never going to die down. This is a poem called Library of Olan, and I'll start with that before I continue. This poem is called Library of Olan. It's a legend that I have imagined about a library which is magical and hopeful even in trying times. The Library of Olan turned upside down the moment bombs of tear gas were thrown into its dusty rooms. The intention was to smoke out the few who refused to leave their obsession of biting into tomes and licking the pages of ancient erotica. Despite all the carefully crafted distraction, there were few romantics who held on to the humor of books and the pleasures of marginalia. So smitten and surprisingly entertained were they that the police thought of making them cry, hoping that sad and dejected, they will give up their long exile with words. It is now a historical fact that the opposite happened. They went mad with pleasure at the prospect of reading with eyes perpetually filled with tears. The words became mistier, more enigmatic, and the sentences would dance like waves. Even scientific manuals seemed to carry the depth of rivers, and they could now easily laugh till they cry at the fascistic stupidity of great poets. When the news went out, the people in large numbers began migrating to Olan and queuing up outside the library gate to experience what they claimed was an altered state of emotion, a chance to feel the things they have never felt in ways that they have never imagined. The entire weight of dialectical philosophy could be felt at the smallest turns of phrases. Even the most basic comedies were now laced with a tinge of melancholia. The artificial gas tears made it possible to call out the manipulation of sentimental lyrics and the longing to cry out of will and not force intensified the empathy for star-crossed lovers. In the constant state of deferred catharsis, Aristotle's complex thesis about dramatic structure came undone. Disregarding the causal root of plot, readers started wandering in the bylanes of unimportant scenes, looking for characters without arcs. When inside the library, people exchanged glances, they were overcome by the realization that while they may be crying similarly, they all radically differed in the ways they were feeling, sensing, living, and loving at any given moment in time. The acknowledgement of such an intimate distance was so poignant that the library sunk into a deep silence without the librarian's interruptions or signs of strict instructions. If you visit the library of Olan today, you'll find that the carpets register the traces of your footsteps as gently as the sand on the seashore does. If you touch the wooden bookshelves, you'll wonder how they didn't rot despite being so damp for so many years. If you turn the pages of any book, you'll be able to run your fingers not only over the printed words, but also over the lasting pattern of fallen tears. Another thing that sort of leapt out at me when I was reading some excerpts of the Rayaprol letters was the sense of isolation that he was also feeling, a sense of lack of community. But we also know that it is out of that solitude that sometimes poetry emerges. And I think a very particular perspective that Rayaprol had on the most ordinary things. I remember this poem where he talks about trees not shedding their overcoats, and it's such a beautiful sort of observation. I think angular desire is also such a wonderful sort of way to look at how what the gaze of the poet is, perhaps, as Emily Dickinson says, tell the truth but tell it slant. And it's really perhaps that sort of quality which sometimes solitude and exile and even being at odds with the majority or the community brings in somebody. I have also, however, been very fortunate to not feel that lack of community. It is thanks to a lot of people, starting from my parents, I've said so many things about them in so many ways that it's hard to find newer and newer ways to thank them. But I think I'll start with, I'll say this, that my father was the first person who brought me my first copy of Premchand. He also had a wonderful habit of borrowing books from friends and never reading them. So thankfully the books would enter the house and be lying there unread. So that's how I read Anna Karenina, Maxim Gorky, and down to all sorts of books, including Upamanyu Chatterjee, till, you know, so he would get all these books and not read it or partially read it. And then I would somehow, you know, read it and then flick them away from the shelf. His friends have lost lots of books because of me. So that's what I'll say about him. And my mother plays a very special role in especially poetry, because she always wanted to recite poetry. She said that she used to sit in the audience when recitation competitions would go on in school, and she had this real desire to be on stage and recite poetry. But she said that I was very nervous and I was very unconfident. But when I was born and when I started going to school, my mother really made sure that I participated in recitation competitions, and she was the first person who taught me how to recite a poem. And she's not here today with us, but I think I have carried that enthusiasm for life and poetry through her, and I'm deeply thankful for her. My brother Nishant, who is such a quiet soul, we don't talk much, but I think There is such a deep camaraderie. He's the only one in the family now. Thankfully, I have a comrade within the family to fight my father against Modi. So it's a great feeling, thankfully. I mean, otherwise I would have been really isolated. So that's another thing which is, well, I'm really thankful for. But apart from family, the other thing which has happened to me are my friends and lovers. It's such a beautiful sort of feeling to be in company of friends, and who've played a very different role. They have not only comforted me, actually, every single good friend of mine and every single lover of mine have challenged me to the core to really rethink my own assumptions, my own personality. And I think they have done a very crucial part, as Kabir says. We were discussing yesterday in the session that Kabir says that, you know, sometimes the pot should break. Only then will there be any sense of, you know. So I think whatever you grow up with becomes a very neat constructed pot. And when I sort of traveled for education, etc., made new friends, I think the pot was broken by them, because they asked me really challenging questions. And without that sort of piercing hammer, it's very hard to bring out the shine and stones. So I think it's, I'm really grateful for the friends, for their generosity, especially Naveen and Shobna, who were my teachers and then they became my friends, who introduced me to poetry. Naveen gave me my first copy of a Hindi translation of a Polish poet, Wisława Szymborska, and that like completely changed my life. And then when I was in college, Shobna from the English Department of Christ University was my first teacher. She really cracked poetry open for me. And incidentally, the poem that completely turned my view of poetry upside down was This Is Just to Say by William Carlos Williams. And it's such a serendipitous thing that we are talking about William Carlos Williams today. I think, and I'll read another poem. So I thought I'll intersperse my thank yous with poems so that neither of the two gets boring and monotonous. So I'll read another poem. This poem is called Body Nation. And this poem too is, I'll not say what it is about because it's unnecessary. This is a poem called Body Nation. The country of my body has passed a farman signed by the head, the thumb forced to attest, with two eyes as witnesses, I no longer belong here. My ears have no patience for my language. My tongue repeats the same silent songs. Caught between rage and heartbreak, it is unbearably dry. But my hands have decided that they will not offer a single drop of water, poison, or prayer. I have now come to know for sure that the taste of the tongue, I have now come to know for sure that the tongue holds on to the abandoned most dearly, that taste is the last sense you lose. Once while kissing the earth in prayer, I had erred and stuck my tongue out. Today, I'll do as ordered. Here, I'm giving up the thick taste of soil that happens to be my final memory. Here, I'm bidding my body goodbye. Here, I'm kissing it one last time. My lips are so cold that this ample body nation, once mine, now yours, catches fire in shock. I'll see from a distance with cold nerves, flesh returning to ashes. Thank you. And now, finally, I want to thank two institutions, Mara and Kabir Project. Mara is an arts collective in Bangalore who I worked with for a year, and made some really lasting friends and enemies there. I think I quarrel with them the most politically. Sometimes I'm amazed how much we can quarrel when there are bhakts around, you know. Like, I mean, despite that, we can quarrel so much amongst each other, even when we are on the same side. But yeah, Mara, which really nurtured me and gave a sort of different kind of opening to look at the city of Bangalore especially, and to put me very in great proximity to poets, to politics, but also poetry and cinema. That's Mara is also the place where I heard lots of stories about Jerry, incidentally, through Ekta Mittal. So that's another sort of like a happy coincidence. And the second place, Kabir Project, which has just sort of overturned my life in a very interesting way. I had grown up reading no poetry. Then I started reading a lot of English and American poetry. And then when I came to Kabir Project, of course, I'd read some bit of Bhakti poetry before, but when I came to Kabir Project, it opened up such a vast variety of poems, which were not the traditional Indian poems from the Brahminical fold, so to speak, but they were poems from Kabir, Meera, Sufi poems from Bulle Shah, Amir Khusro, singers, Qawwali singers from Pakistan, to encounter poetry in song and be so moved with it. I think that also shifted the way I was writing poetry very significantly. And more than that, Shabnam and Kabir Project and Srishti have been such dear sort of supporters of my craft. I work freelance with Kabir Project and I still don't have a full-time job. But I think it's through Kabir Project where I always sort of find some bit of grounding in life. Apart from finances, thank you. But I've managed to be independent because of institutions like Kabir Project, which really value the work of an individual and what an individual can bring to the project. Through Kabir Project, I have started developing courses on poetry. I've got a chance to teach Kabir, which I never thought I would. But I mean, it's such a joy to be in such places. And finally, I want to thank Shruti, my partner, and I don't know what can I say about this relationship, because it's one of those relationships which really sort of broke the core of my personality to the point where I could literally feel afresh. I could literally question every single thing and arrive at some deeply, deeply important questions. More than providing answers, this is one sort of person who has filled my life with, and I'll say this, beautiful questions. And I think she has taught me how to question. And I think it's, although I'm questioning for a long time, but sometimes you also need somebody to tell you what the right questions are. And I'm deeply sort of grateful to it. And I think what we also together started Brown Study, which is a sort of oasis for me, and which is what sustains our practice, which is where we find our voice and our hope in these extremely sort of sometimes hopeless times. But we are very hopeful people. And we are very hopeful because we know that sometimes things have to really break for any creation to happen. And I'm going to read a last poem of mine, which is called Kintsugi. And I think this idea of Kintsugi encapsulates what I also feel about art and poetry. Kintsugi is a Japanese art of when ceramic bowls break down. Those pieces are collected and then the pot is rebuilt using gold. So it's a process of making something broken even more beautiful than perhaps it was, not by hiding its cracks, but by really intensifying its cracks. And I think that's what art does. Art does two things. One, it breaks the molds that we've been living with all our lives. It makes us confront the breakdown of things. The questioning of things which we have considered, you know, accepted. And second is also the process of healing through generous, compassionate, empathetic expression, space, listening. It provides a way for broken things to heal. So this process of kintsugi, which sort of does both, and I feel that one experience which does both these things is the experience of love. And my only sort of goal as a poet, I feel, in these hyper-nationalistic times is to always continue to write love poems. So this is one such love poem called Kintsugi. The first green of spring, the gentle pink blossoms have announced your arrival in this city of mine. In this city of mine, lean-bodied men have stopped their work midway, in the middle of a busy afternoon. They are listening at present to the symphony of their transistors being tuned to catch an unknown melody amid distortions, horns, signals, and impatience. A half-done flyover hangs dangerously over them. They've given up the mending of roads, and large billboards are either empty or draped with incomplete pictures. Buildings, roses, promises have all been left undone. I know you have arrived. The stars have come out of their hiding. The moon has forgotten her cycles. The calculation of her periods is a mess. All the women have stopped sleeping at night to look out of their windows at the streets to catch your shadows and listen to the rhythm of your unruly steps. I know you passed by my street last night. Newspapers have turned shockingly banal. Soaps have lost their plot. Characters in stories are loitering without purpose on pages which smell neither new nor old. Lilies have entered the kitchens. Violets have returned to the soil. Priests are reading haikus, and clerks have stained their hearts blue. In their pockets, pens have started leaking, and birds are flying in their dreams. You will leave without paying visit again. Once again, you'll make incisions from a distance and forget about suturing. You'll leave a taste of longing on our tongues for the whiff of your skin or the toes of your feet. Our fingers will be scanning the surface of our realities for remains of your golden hair and needles of your unsaid words. We'll once again mend our porcelain selves, fill all the cracks with gold and pain. We'll make ourselves beautiful for you to break us again. Finally, I just wanted to end this session with a translation that I did of a Faiz Ahmed Faiz poem, which I felt compelled to read today because it's a prayer, and perhaps it sounds very much, is a Pakistani poet, and it's perhaps very important for us to read prayers in these times, but prayers which are, as Faiz says, not of the religious. So this is a translation of a Faiz poem called Dua, which starts with the line, Aiye Haath Uthaye. So I'm just going to read the translation. A prayer. Let us also raise our hands in prayer, we who have forgotten all the rules of praying, we who are struck by the passion of love and have no patience for the sanctity of gods. Let us file petitions to dig up a thing of beauty, something to fill the cup of today's poison with sweet whispers of tomorrow. For those crumbling under the weight of daily trials, let us unburden their days and let the nights fall more gently on their soft lashes. For those who have confused lies for faith, let us wish that they be granted the strength to disbelieve and the curiosity to question. for those bowing down, unaware of the swords of their guardians, let us wish that they be granted the will to disobey and the power to walk away. Let us publicly declare the hidden secret of love. Let us put the longings of our hearts to rest. The words of truth that prick the insides of our being, let us bring them out into the open and end this suffering. Let us also raise our hands in prayer, we who have forgotten all the rules of praying. This tangles with power that be is not new. Their rights of oppression are not new, and our will to resist is very old. We have pulled flowers out of embers before. They will lose again, we will win again. There is nothing unusual in this. We don't complain endlessly to the skies about this mess. For when we think of you, Evatan, we choose not to be bitter. Thank you. If I can, as a sort of sign off, I would like to remember two other women, my two grandmothers. One grandmother who really, really wanted to be with me, my father's mother, Nainamma. And one other woman, Amamma, who passed away when I was very young. She's somewhere far, far away. But she's, I think, one of the persons who influenced me the most. And in that very sort of formative years, with her sheer gentle presence, there are two small Hindi poems which I remember by heart, just three lines each, about the two of them. One, आकाश के टुकड़े नहीं होते, हर टुकड़े का अपना आकाश होता है. नानी के छज्जे से आसमान को देखो. नानी का सूती आंचल नजर आता है. एंड द अदर पोएम इज फॉर माय दादी. दादी, तुम इतना तेज चलकर भी इतना कम कैसे चलती हो? बेटा, तुम मेरी गति नहीं, मेरे पैर देखो, छोटे हैं. थैंक यू.
And it is really my duty, it is my pleasure to thank all the people who have made it possible. First, I'd like to thank Amita and Sridhala from the HLF for providing this wonderful platform and audience. And then it is with humble appreciation and a very emotional moment for me that I speak about Graziano Cratley from Yale University, a librarian, author, translator, editor, and acknowledge his wonderful contribution to reviving the works of Srinivas Rayaprol. It was in 2015, with a stroke of luck and hand of fate, that my sister came upon his article or his paper on the web. And then, I don't know who contacted whom first. Yeah, I think you contacted her. When you wrote the paper entitled "The News from That Strange Faraway Land," William Carlos Williams apostrophe Indian Sun followed by G in brackets. It is so overwhelming for us that you have elevated my father to the position of this great man's son, ironically, who also happens to be the son of another famous Indian poet, as we all know over here. And this paper was written and presented at the conference of the WCW Society in June 2015, am I right? And published in the WCW Review. It was a 40-page article. I was so overwhelmed by it, I sent it to all my near and dear. It was so sensitively written with intense insight into the poet and the man, Srinivas Rayaprol, in spite of never having met him, but knew him only through his writings. You made us learn so much about our father, which we ourselves didn't know in those 40 pages. My father-in-law, who was one of my father's best friends, told his son, "You should be proud to be his son-in-law," after reading that article of yours. Following this, Graziano embarked on a journey to publish the two books already spoken about at length earlier. I would like to emphasize here that he did all this with tremendous commitment, collecting, collating, getting experts' opinions, getting the relevant permissions, getting the right publishers to agree to print the books, and with so much of sincere concern to bring back Rayaprol into the poetic circles of India, with help from Arvind Krishna Mehrotra and Vivek Narayan and some more people. And the family and Rayaprol Trust will always be deeply indebted to you for this gigantic gesture of yours. I wish to show my great appreciation, Jerry's gone, to Jerry and Aishwarya Iyer for pouring life into the letters through their readings. I felt I was listening to my dad. We were not fortunate enough, we were too young. He didn't put those letters in our hands. But later once when Aparna was in America and she came for one of her holidays, he handed them over to her and asked her to donate them to some library over there, and she did it to the University of Austin. But today we got to hear excerpts, and we are so happy that you've written the book, and I'll be able to read all of them and relive my life through my father's writings. I would like to mention here, just a few seconds more, that my father, in spite of coming through as a very lonely and I don't know what are the other words, yeah, solitary person, the people who knew him would never guess that. In one of your letters to Aparna, you asked what his life was like. The same boring government job he spoke about, he excelled in it. Even today, people talk about his contribution as a civil engineer to the Andhra Pradesh government. And he made best of friends at work, his workplace, his childhood friends from Maritpalli, a small locality in Secunderabad, his friends from his poetic circle. In fact, on his last journey, his granddaughters commented, "I wish Tata could see the number of people mourning him." He had so many friends that no one would believe he was lonely. That loneliness came from not being a poet and from poetry not being engulfing him. He was an exemplary father, exemplary wife. My parents had one of the best marriages. My mother complimented him in every way. Another set of letters that have lost to us are the letters my mother used to read to us. The letters written by my great-grandfather, Pattabhi Sitaramaya, to my father, and my father to him. Pattabhi's other granddaughters are also here, my mother's cousins. They're younger than me, of course. What wonderful letters. But I never got to hear these letters today. I wish we could get the Pattabhi collection also and give it to you, but I don't know where they are. So, sorry for diverting. I thank Professor Anna Kurian from the Hyderabad University, head of the department, who has been supportive for this year's and also previous year's prize events and has also consented to chair the session today. We thank you very much. Coming to the star of the evening, Prashant Parvataneni, I thank him for raising the bar of the Poetry Prize, along with the other winners before him who have all been truly worthy of the prize. We are indeed proud to have you among our winners list, and I'm sure all of you youngsters, through the power of your word and the gift that God has given you, or you have given yourself or developed yourself, will be able to express yourselves about what's happening in society around you and maybe change things if you will wish to. For this, I have to thank the jury of this year, poet Jeev Patel from Mumbai, Professors Murli Manohar and Girish Pawar of the Department of English, for spotting this gem from among the other entries. The PR of UOH, Ashish Jacob Thomas and Pranay Rupani, have been doing their bit for promotion of the event through photographs, videos, print and social media posts, for which we are truly grateful. Ganesh from SIP, the quiet little boy in the Study India program of UOH, as always, helps in sorting out and distribution of the numerous entries received for the prize. My sister Aparna, the driving force behind execution of all the events of the Rayaprol Prize through the years, has been doing an exemplary job, and all of us truly appreciate and support her. Finally, I thank you all, the audience, for being part of this celebration, a really true celebration, and I hope you enjoyed the session and you'll enjoy tomorrow also. Thank you.
Thank you.